Fantasy sports has become one of the best ways for fans to elevate their viewing experience every season. I, for one, am a huge fan of participating in fantasy sports and play in a ton of football, hockey, and basketball leagues with my friends throughout the fall and winter. It gets me way more interested in the entirety of each league rather than just focusing on my favorite teams and players to watch, and I feel like it's just made me appreciate these sports a lot more. So with the NHL season beginning in just a few weeks, I thought I'd make fantasy hockey the focal point of this video. I'm going to be entering into one of Yahoo Fantasy's mock drafts and will be drafting a team which I will then be putting into NHL 23's franchise mode to see how well they would perform over an 82 game season and to see if we can win a Stanley Cup. So let's get started. All right, so the first thing that we're going to do is randomize our position in this draft. So let's spin the wheel. We got 1 to 14. I figured I'd make it a 14-team draft just so it can be a little bit more difficult for us to get good players, but I think this roster is going to be stacked regardless. Let's see where we're going to pick. Okay, so it's going to be pick number 10. So that's nice, so we'll kind of be close to getting two picks relatively close to each other. Yeah, let's head over to the draft now. All right, so here we are in the Yahoo Fantasy Sports pre-draft lobby. And we're going to start queuing up some players for us to draft. Now, of course, I'm going to try and do a good balance of what would be a good fantasy team as well as a good team in NHL 23's franchise mode, which I don't think will be very hard because obviously the best players are close to the top. Now, I'm looking here at around pick number 10, which we have, and I see Brady Tkachuk, who's one of the best fantasy players around. If you guys play fantasy sports, fantasy hockey, rather, definitely look at getting him. His peripherals with shots on goal, hits, and blocks as well are awesome. He's just a super active player, so I'll definitely keep him in mind. Obviously, they have Matthews here at the expected rank of 11. I don't think he'll go there. If you look at rank-wise, he's ranked a lot higher at skater number 6. I would actually probably put him a bit higher. But I do know defense goes very quickly in this, so I'm going to start looking at some defensemen. And I'm going to look at Rasmus Dahlin. He's a great offensive defenseman. Roman Josi as well, slips pretty low. Dougie Hamilton. Pretty much the way you want to do it for defensemen is draft them pretty early. That's how I go, at least, just because I know the top-heavy ones will fade out really quickly. And you want to get ones that are on power play one time, like Evan Bouchard with the Edmonton Oilers. 30 seconds left. Let's get to the draft. All right, and the draft begins, and players are starting to get picks. You see McDavid, Drysdale, and Pasternak, 1, 2, 3. Not really a big surprise there. I don't know if I'm willing to take Pasternak 3 this season just because of the fact that Boston's roster's kind of dropped off a little bit. You see McKinnon goes 4. It's a good pick. Matthews 5, like we predicted, would go a little higher. Tkachuk, Kucherov, Robertson, and Rantanen. So now it's our pick. All right, so I think, like I said, I might go with Brady Tkachuk. I just think he's probably the best overall fantasy forward out of this group here. Maybe Jack Hughes as well would be a good pick. But yeah, let's just stick with Brady Tkachuk. Haven't used him in one of these simulations, so I think that'll be cool. Wow, okay, this guy just drafted Adam Lowry, 12th overall. That's kind of insane. Right after Jack Hughes, just thought I'd point that out. Not sure what he's up to here, but there could be a little bit of funny business going on. So Cale Makar goes all the way to 16th here. So this guy's got Tage Thompson and Cale Makar. Kind of a crazy stack there for him to start off with. I think that's really, really low for Cale Makar to be picked 16th. Definitely a top 10 fantasy player when you look at his ability to score, get points, plus minus, power play. Just the shot volume as well for a defenseman is just unheard of. Him and Roman Josi are in that elite category there. All right, so we see Igor Shesterkin goes 18th. I was kind of hoping I was going to get that pick there, unfortunately. But I think next I'm going to go with Vasilevsky. The only reason I'm taking him over Sorokin here is just from the volume. I feel like Vasilevsky will end up playing more games and winning more games with Tampa. So let's take Andre Vasilevsky. Oh, and we see Timo Meier go 32nd. I was kind of hoping to get him. Wow, this guy's got a really good set of forwards here with McKinnon, Stützle, and Meier already. We got to go after a defenseman here or a really elite forward. I'm not sure what to do here. I'll just wait till it comes around to my turn. All right, so we are up, and pretty much everyone I wanted just got taken, which is kind of unfortunate. All right, we're running out of time. I don't know who to go with. I think I'm just going to go with the number one suggested player, and that's JT Miller. Not really mad about that. For NHL simulation, there were going to be better players to pick, but I think for fantasy-wise, you just look at the category coverage by him, and he kind of checks off all the boxes. Pretty good forward overall. So we got JT Miller, Brady Tkachuk, and Andrei Vasilevskiy. I think I'm going to try and go for... Wow, okay, so someone took Dahlin. I'm going to hope that Yossi's still hanging around here for me. Like I said, defensemen go pretty quickly, so it's important to get at least one or two elite ones early on. All right, so Roman Josi just got taken at 43. It seems like everyone has a really good stack of players except for me right now. This guy's got Kaprizov, Marner, and Josi. So the 10th slot isn't really working out for us too well fantasy-wise, but I think NHL-wise, we still got a pretty good group of players. All right, and it's our pick now, and I know this might be a bit of a reach just based on some of the skilled players ahead of him. We do need a defenseman, and I'm going to take Dougie Hamilton. He's going to have that power play one time in New Jersey. He's definitely going to be racking up a ton of points that way. Although Luke Hughes could be in line to take that spot for him, who knows. But definitely like Dougie Hamilton as our number one defenseman. All right, it's our pick again, and unfortunately, Clayton Keller just went. He was actually on my list of players that I wanted to take. Next up, there's a ton of good forwards here, but I really just want to rack up more defensemen, I think. And I think I'm going to take Evan Bouchard here. Power play one in Edmonton. Can't really go wrong with that. Welcome, Evan Bouchard. So now our team is JT Miller, Brady Tkachuk, Dougie, Bouchard, and Vassy. All right, and now we just keep getting our players stolen. Moritz Seider just got taken before us. Let's check out Brandon's team here, because he's got Dahlin, Heiskanen, Seider. Yeah, he's got the right idea for sure. I'm really torn here. Defenseman, nobody's really standing out to me. We're running out of time. I want Dylan Cousins. I think he's going to have a big breakout year yet again with the Buffalo Sabres. Already had 30 goals last year. I think they're going to be pushing for a playoff spot, and he's going to be a big focal point of that. So I don't mind taking Cousins as our second center. All right, so now we have to pick a right winger because we have absolutely nobody there. And I think I'm just going to go to the best available, Rickard Rakell. Obviously going to be on the top forward line in Pittsburgh there. I think he's a safe bet. There's not really anyone else jumping out at me that I really like because our centermen are pretty good. So let's go with Rickard Rakell. All right, we are back up, and I'm thinking defense maybe. We got a little bit, and we only have Dougie and Bouchard. I don't mind Vince Dunn just because he's going to have top power play time in Seattle. I'm also thinking of Cole Caulfield here, though, but I think he might fly under the radar, so I think I could take Vince Dunn here. So our defense is filling out pretty nicely with Hamilton, Bouchard, and Dunn, all pretty offensively heavy defensemen. Might need to fill out another winger spot with this next pick, or maybe even another backup goalie. There's still some big names on the board here. I think we could get someone. All right, and we are back up, and I just noticed that Evander Kane is still on the board, and I think we're going to take him. Obviously missed a good amount of time last season with injury. Great, like, peripherals with shots and hits, obviously, and he's projected here for almost 30 goals. I don't know if he'll be on the top power play in Edmonton, but I still think if he's in their top six that he's bound to get a lot of points. So I'm going to take Evander Kane. All right, so I'm doing a bit of a reach here. We can see all these names ahead of this guy that I'm about to take. But I'm going to take Morgan Riley. I think there's a lot of speculation that with John Klingberg on the Leafs, that he might take over the power play one spot. I don't really see that happening. Morgan Riley should be the guy, and I'm going to take him. All right, so I'm going to go with Jacob Markstrom. I just feel like he's the safest bet here. Obviously, a pretty down year last season, but I just don't see that happening from him again. He's been one of the most consistent goaltenders over the past decade, pretty much. So I'm comfortable taking him. So let's go Jacob Markstrom. All right, we're back up again. Since there's so many just auto-pick teams, it's not really giving me a lot of time to decide here and prep for my next pick. there's so many names on the board. I just have no idea. I do like Marty Natchez. I know we don't really need a center right now, but he'll be a good bench player for us. Let's go with Martin Natchez. Going to be on the top line power play in Carolina and top six center. Can't really go wrong with that. One of the best regular season teams. Should be a pretty safe pick. All right, guys. So one person who's been kind of flying under the radar in drafts is Patrick Kane, just because he isn't signed to a team right now. I don't think he's going to head into the season without having a contract. Obviously, he's kind of older, but I think not only for our simulation in NHL, but I think for his offensive abilities, there's no reason for him to be going this low. So let's go with Patrick Kane. All right, so we are back up again. And I think I'm going to go with Lucas Raymond. I'm kind of surprised that he's still available just because of his potential. And I know that he had a down year last year, but I think Detroit got better. You can see he's obviously projected for a much higher offensive season than last year. Just with the acquisitions that Detroit had, I think they're going to be much better. Let's go with Lucas Raymond. All right, and I think I'm going to go back with a defenseman now just to kind of round out our just the end of our bench. We only have two more picks. I'm going to go with Bowen Byram. I really like Bowen Byram. I think he's one of the more mature defensemen in the league, just especially being so young. Really gifted player. Obviously, he's not going to have top power play time with Makar, but I think he could definitely have a shot at the second power play in Colorado. So let's go with Bowen. All right, so this is going to be our last selection. I actually have no idea what I want to do here. We don't really have any other right wingers that are super interesting on the board, but I definitely need to fill out that spot. Let's go with Capo Caco. I think he's slotted in on the first line in New York right now on Daily Faceoff. So this could be a huge year for him, and I think I'm willing to bank on him on that that Rangers power play as well. All right, so the team is done. Just looking at how Yahoo projects our team to be looking, we were fifth out of the 14, so not bad with the 10th overall pick there. I think we made out all right. Looking at how our squad looks, we got JT Miller, Dylan Cousins, Brady Tkachuk, Evander Kane, Rickard Rakell, Patrick Kane, Dougie Hamilton, Evan Bouchard, Vince Dunn, Morgan Riley, Martin Natchez, Lucas Raymond, Bowen Byram, and Capo Caco are our skaters. And for goaltending, we got Andre Vasilevsky and Jacob Markstrom, which is just going to be insane to put into a NHL 23 team as a duo there. All right, so let's head over to franchise mode, transfer the team over, and we will show you guys what we have. Okay, so just before we enter into franchise mode, I just want to show you guys that I've removed the Arizona Coyotes, unfortunately. They were the lowest rated franchise, so I just naturally had to remove one in order to put in the Houston Cosmos. As you guys can see, we're putting them into the Central Division, and we are the highest rated team in the NHL already with a 94 overall. I don't think there's anyone higher than us. Yeah. All right, so we are going to hop into franchise mode, and I will show you guys the lines in a moment. Okay, here we are at the main menu for franchise mode. As you can see, Patrick Kane is our team leader there, even though there's no points. It's probably because he's the highest rated forward on our team. And here is our lineup. We got Brady Tkachuk, Martin Natchez, and Kane on the first line with a plus five. Gotta like that for a first unit that we just drafted from our fantasy team. Evander Kane, JT Miller, and Rickard Rakell on a second line, I think is pretty solid, even though we're not like underwhelming offensively, but we're lacking that 90 plus forward that I think a lot of teams have. Dylan Cousins, Lucas Raymond, and Capo Caco is a great third line, three young stars that I think if you were to develop them over a couple of seasons would be insane. Looking at our defense now, we got Dougie Hamilton and Morgan Riley with a plus five on the first pairing. Vince Dunn and Bowen Byram on the second pairing. And Patrick Nemeth and Evan Bouchard on the third pairing. If you guys are wondering how I rounded out the rest of the forwards, I just signed free agents that were available. So we got Joe Thornton, Zach Cassian, and Rocco Grimaldi. Nice to see Jumbo Joe. Hopefully we'll be able to bring him to a Stanley Cup. And I think we have a good chance with our two goaltenders, Andre Vasilevsky and Jacob Markstrom. So we don't have a 90-plus forward, but we have arguably the best goaltender in the game. Power play, we got a plus five on the first unit as well. Even chemistry on the second. Penalty kill is even as well. I really like the makeup of this team. I don't know how it's going to simulate, but of course that's what we're here to find out. So let's get to it. All right, and now we are at the trade deadline. And the Houston Cosmos have a 35-25-2 record. We are third in the Central Division with 72 points, tied with the Nashville Predators. They just have more overtime wins, or overtime losses, I guess. I'm not sure why we would be third over second. Kind of weird. Patrick Kane leading the way with 55 points in 62 games. Nothing too crazy. 27 goals, though, is really solid for him at 34. We've seen him simulate well in the past, and there's just no reason not to go back to him here. Martin Natchez with 54 points, just behind Kane. Obviously on that first line with the plus five chemistry, no surprise that our top three scorers are within 2 points of each other, which is pretty crazy. Dougie Hamilton with a pretty great season, fifth on the team in scoring with 36 points. Ricard Raquel there, 35. Let's check out our goaltenders. We got Andre Vasilevsky with a 907 save percentage. Not that great, but Jacob Markstrom with a 930 there. Not outplaying Vasilevsky, obviously, because he hasn't played as many games. He's got 52 starts, which is pretty crazy for the duo we have. We probably could have adjusted some coaching stuff there to make the splits a little bit more even. But nevertheless, yeah, we're at the trade deadline. I don't want to make any trades just because I wanted to see how this team was going to play out on its own. I think we're in a good spot to make the playoffs. Our division is pretty tight there. As you can see, the Stars are within a point of us. The Jets are tied, and the Predators are just ahead of us. So lots of storylines to look out for here in the final half of the season. Let's simulate through up until the postseason. All right, so the Houston Cosmos are going to be heading to the Stanley Cup playoffs after a great second half following the trade deadline. They finished with a 47-30-5 record to finish second in the Central Division, well ahead of the Nashville Predators, where we were pretty tight with them in the standings before. We separated that gap quite nicely. Brady Tkachuk led the way in scoring with 71 points, but not far behind him was Patrick Kane with 70, 33 goals. Martin Natchez surpassing his previous career high of 41 points, gets 67 this season, so really benefiting from some top-tier line mates in Patrick Kane and Brady Tkachuk. JT Miller also with a pretty solid season, 20 goals and 52 points. Not too shabby there. Dougie Hamilton once again. Pretty great offensive stuff there, obviously. Not a career high, but pretty close to it. Just what we were expecting from a plus five on your top pairing, obviously. Morgan Rielly, not really a great goal scorer historically. His 20 goals in 2018-19 were pretty uncharacteristic, and you can see it's his shooting percentage was super high back then. But pretty good season from him, still 88 overall. Lucas Raymond, though, jumps up to an 87. He's 21 years old. He finished with 19 goals, 28 points. So not even really like that great of a season by his standards. But I guess just playing with talented players, he naturally progressed, which can't complain about that on our part heading into the postseason. Looking at our goaltenders now, Andre Vasilevsky finishes with a 910 save percentage in 71 games played. I don't know what I could have done to fix that. If you guys have any idea, please leave a comment for me. Because Jake Markstrom finished with a 930 save percentage, and I'm sure we would have liked to manage the load a little bit there for Vasilevsky, but still with a great season for him. just under 3 goals against average as well, so can't complain. I mean, with that amount of starts, to put up a 9-10 save percentage is pretty remarkable. But without further ado, let's see who we're going to be playing in the first round of the Stanley Cup playoffs. And it's going to be the Nashville Predators. All right, so our division rival there. Let's take a look at how their team was shaping up. I mean, they were competitive with us for majority of the season until we pulled ahead. And it's a pretty decent lineup. I mean, they're pretty top-heavy with Forsberg and O'Reilly as their two best forwards. Cody Glass is an all right second-line center for them, but then it just kind of drops off as well. I mean, I can't talk too much. Our fourth line is probably actually worse than this just because we had to sign free agents. Looking at defense, though, they're pretty solid with Roman Josi, Tyson Barrie, Dante Fabbro, and Ryan McDonagh as their top four. Goaltending, UC Saros, of course. Let's see what type of season he had. Just so consistent. You see the save percentages there. 916, 917, 927. Easily one of the best goalies of the past decade that I think is really not underrated, but just underappreciated, I'll say. Just because we're in such a great era of goaltenders right now. All right, well, let's get to simulating here. Like we always do, we're going to go through the first 3 games. And game number 1 is a loss. Game number 2 is a win. Game number 3 is a win. All right, so we got a 2-1 series lead heading into game number 4. Series is tied after game number 5. Okay, so we are on the brink of elimination here. Let us head into the simulation. This would be a real shame. We've been on a pretty hot streak with these simulation videos. I feel like we've constructed a solid team here. So no scoring after the first period. 1-1 after the second. Vince Dunn, and I don't even know who you are, brother. Oh no, I just simulated the third. Wow, okay. I accidentally simulated the third period, but thank God it's going to overtime. Roman Josi and Lucas Raymond with one... Was that 1 second in or 1 second left? Wow. Okay. That's pretty insane if it was 1 second left, but I feel like when they do this countdown, it means 1 second in. But it can't be 1 second in if you're scoring from there. So Lucas Raymond tied the game for us to send it to overtime with 1 second left. Oh my goodness. Let's jump into this game. So I just thought I'd give you guys a look at the Houston Comets jerseys just before we get started here. The homes, there they are, and the aways, of course. We're going to be on the road for this game, so that's okay. But Patrick Kane there with the C for us. 97, 95 offense. Wow, offense, defense, that's insane. So we're definitely rated a lot higher than them. 97, 95, 96. Wow. Okay. And we're salary cap compliant, too. That was something I totally forgot to even mention. So that's just another great addition to this story here. Pucks dropped. Let's try and win it in OT. And I completely forgot to make it CPU, CPU. Patrick Kane, it looks like he is wearing number 5, which is just absolutely criminal. Of course, I always forget to change the numbers for these players. That's ridiculous. I mean, if we get through this game, I'll see if I can adjust it. It's not really normal to change your number in the middle of the season, but I mean, hey, we can't have Patrick Kane wearing number 5. It's just not right. Forsberg now with a little space, tries to make a move, he does, but he can't retrieve it, and Riley will make a nice play to pick it up and give it up to Bowen Byram. JT Miller now takes a shot, and that is stopped by Saros. Lucas Raymond giving it up to Vince Dunn with a little room. Miller, Cousins now, gets a shot off and it's stopped by Saros. Forsberg with it, makes a dangerous play to the middle, but luckily the Predators will get it out. And here comes Forsberg now with some space. Evangelista, and that's stopped by Vasilevsky. See, normally with any other goaltender, I'd be so nervous for this many opportunities we're giving up, but we have Andrei Vasilevsky. I feel like if any team can bank on their goaltender, it's us right now. The end of the first overtime. I thought we might have a couple more seconds to make a play there, but we did not. Still 2-2 after the first overtime. Let's end this thing. Up to Patrick Kane now. Patrick Kane with a windmill move. Can't get through Roman Josi. That would have been an amazing move there if he could have continued to move with the puck. Nature's down to Tkachuk. Back to Riley. Oh, I thought Tkachuk had a pretty good look there, but he just didn't let it go. Still a nice chance there, but not what we need right now. We need a goal. And Luke Evangelista is rocked there. And here comes Yossi. Yossi with some room. Feeds it off to Evangelista. A shot. And that is gloved once again by Vasilevsky for a whistle. Here comes Byron now. Byron with a breakaway pretty much. And he scores. It wasn't really a breakaway, but Bowen Byram buries a goal and keeps this series alive. He just had like a perfectly open lane to walk to the middle of the net, and he just picks the top right corner past UC Saros. What a big moment for the young defenseman. Like I said, he's one of my favorite offensive defensemen in the league. Let's take another look at this. Riley. Nope, that's just not the goal at all. There it is right there. Byram just walking right down Main Street and picking one right over the glove of UC Saros. All right, time for game 7 of this first round series. After a heroic performance there by Bowen Byram to get us to this game, let's see what we can do. First period, 2-0 Houston. Michael Carconi and Lucas Raymond, one of our fourth line signings, proving to be worth his dollar in this game. Second period now. 5-0 Houston. 2 goals by Patrick Kane and another one by Lucas Raymond. All right, I feel pretty comfortable simulating through this third, so let's see. And it's just going to be 6-0. JT Miller. That's a wrap on round one. All right, for round number two, we have the Edmonton Oilers, of course. Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl. There probably will be a duplicate of Evander Kane, if I'm correct. Yeah. So we're going up against our own player. He's got 8 points in 7 games. Let's see how McDavid's doing. Just 6-7. See, this is so interesting to me. I mean, obviously, this is a great series, but it's not like their standard of production. We know they do like 2 points per game in the playoffs, right? Like, that's not out of the realm of possibility for Connor McDavid. Stuart Skinner not playing great at all. An 8.71 save percentage. But Jack Campbell might be their starter for this series, as he had 21 save performance for a 9.13 save percentage. Yeah, not sure who we're going to be coming up against, but they're the Edmonton Oilers. I mean, they're a pretty good team. Connor McDavid, you know, Leon Draisaitl. All right, first two games we take. 2-0 there. Let's see how we can do in game number 3. And it's going to be a loss. So now it is 2-1. Next game, we win, so we are on the verge of eliminating the Edmonton Oilers. Very nice, very nice. But we can't. All right, let's see if we can do it in 6 rather than 7, and we're going to go to another game 7. Okay. I don't like game 7s. First period, and it's going to be 1-0 Houston. Zach Cassian, our fourth liners, are really doing all the work for us here. Second period, it's going to be 1-1. Matthias Ekholm. All right. So we don't really have any of the star power showing up yet, but you got to imagine they're going to show up in the big moments of this game. Edmonton on the power play. Wow. And we kill off what was a prolific Edmonton power play this past season. And Evander Kane for them. I thought it was for us. Evander Kane for them gets them on the board. Okay. We got 3 minutes left. Why not get into a simulation to see if we can try and tie this game up? All right, here we are, just over 3 minutes remaining. Can Houston keep their playoff hopes alive? Here is Morgan Riley. Turns it over there, but there's a big hit. And Tkachuk will pick it up to Natchez. Natchez, oh, to Kane. What a grade A chance, but Stuart Skinner shuts the door. Still pressing here is Houston. Kane now. There's Hamilton with Kane, giving it down to Natchez. This is just how you wanted to start the last 3 minutes, I guess. All right, Dougie, what are you going to do here? Oh, tries to make a nice pass up to Kane. Can't. Turns it over to McDavid. And here comes Houston back the other way with just 40 seconds left. Can we make something happen? No, it's going to be turned over to McDavid, and we have an empty net. But we'll get bodies in front of it. All right, one last chance here is JT Miller. Turns it over again. Lucas Raymond, Hamilton, Patrick Kane, centers it. Oh, we can't get the shot through. 20 seconds left. Patrick Kane gets it up, centers it. Ricard Raquel, a shot. Oh, and it's tipped, but it's gloved by Stuart Skinner. I got to get another look at that. I don't think I've ever seen an animation like this. Look at Ricard Raquel. He has a wide open look here. And he just, he wires it. It goes off Ekholm. And then Raymond tries to tip it in, but it goes right into the glove and chest of Stuart Skinner. 15 seconds left. Let's see if we can make some magic happen. All right, it's going to be JT Miller on the draw here with Lucas Raymond and Ricard Raquel. Final shift. Miller wins the draw. Gets it to Riley, a shot. Raymond with a chance. Raquel, no. And they can't get the shot off. This could be it, but Kachuk turns it over. 5 seconds left. Gotta get one on net. Kachuk wide open. No. Oh my gosh. Kachuk had a wide open look there, and he elected to saucer pass, which led to a turnover. Oh. That is heartbreaking. But, you know, we were on a heck of a run here, like, over the past few videos, winning consecutive Stanley Cup championships. Oh, you just can't do it 3 times in a row, I guess. All right, so, unfortunately, we didn't accomplish our goal, and it just didn't really feel like we had it in us in this. I mean, you go to 2 consecutive Game 7s, you have a 3-1 lead. Yeah, you're gonna lose it at some point there. But Patrick Kane with a great playoff showing, 20 points through 14 games. Let's see who we could have asked a little bit more of here. Scrolling down, let's see some forwards. Dylan Cousins, kind of disappointing. Only 4 points through 14 games. Just a disappointing simulation from the young fella. Capo Caco as well. 4 points. 18 points in the whole season. Not great. But he jumped up to an 85 overall somehow. Vander Kane as well, only 3 points, kind of disappointing stuff. Like, when you're matching with Rocco Grimaldi and Zach Cassian in terms of production, or at least you're relatively close, it's just not a good sign. It wasn't from a lack of good goaltending. Vasilevsky with 915 save percentage, he played all 14 games, of course. Yeah, just disappointed. So just before we wrap up here, obviously I like to show how the whole simulation went for the rest of the league. So Mikko Rantanen finished with 52 goals and 111 points, which was the most in the NHL. He'll be taking home the Art Ross. Right behind him is his teammate Nathan MacKinnon with 108 points. I believe that's his first season with over 100 points. Obviously he had 99 back in 2019, but good on you. Connor McDavid, 101. Literally just a bad season by his standards, which is hilarious. Draisaitl, 198. Yeah, I feel like you gotta have more 100-point players in a simulation like this. I don't know what I need to do. Let's check out some of the goaltenders. Thatcher Demko with a 45-win season. Nice. Don't really care about goalies. Let's check out the awards. All right, looking at the awards, here we see the Boston Bruins took home the Stanley Cup Championship. Congratulations for them. One last hurrah for that older core. Kind of probably what they wish they did this past season. Mikko Rantanen, of course, takes home the Art Ross, like we said. Then he takes home the Hart as well. Norris goes to Makar. Lady Bing to Pasta. Calder to Bedard. Funny enough, I think that's the first time he's actually won the Calder in any of my simulation videos, which is kind of hilarious. Conn Smythe goes to Jake DeBrusk. All right, so he must have had a great playoff run there. Vezina Trophy goes to Ilya Sorokin, William N. Jennings, which is funny because we did have the option to take Sorokin in our fantasy draft earlier, but we didn't. I'm sure that's going to be the case for a lot of the players on this list. W. Dingle takes home the Jack Adams. Good on you. Selke goes to Sidney Crosby. I don't know if he's ever won a Selke before. I could be wrong. Ted Lindsay goes to Mika Rantanen. Maurice Richard goes to Mika Rantanen. Great season for the Avalanche on the awards front. All right, well, that's just going to about wrap things up here. Thank you all so much for following along. I think it's going to be interesting to see the people in the comments talk about all the players that could have gotten. But we tried our best, and that's all that matters, right? Please leave a comment if you enjoyed. Leave a like as well, and don't forget to subscribe. And I hope you guys have a lovely day.